Well, where are you from?
Pittsburgh.
And what brought you here? Why did you come here?
I've been dealing with TMJ for about, I want to say 3 years.
Yeah.
And, it just got to that point last September where, I was just so done with splints and it just would hurt. I'd put it in, just my whole face would just feel like it's on fire. And I just, I almost was to the point of like just giving up with splints altogether. I couldn't bear having to go to another dentist or to another orthodontist to see, if you could help me with my problem. And that's when I found out about your videos and I started watching your videos and I started seeing you, help these different people with TMJ problems.
Yeah.
And that's when I was like, I think I should give this a chance,
You've been through the screening. We did the neural occlusion screening on you. So to be clear, what we do is not just DTR. We're actually trying to look at joints and muscle and stuff and bites from like an orthopedic angle. Orthopedic, a biomechanical, and like a physiologic way. So our big thing is like we're trying to put numbers to everything, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you've seen us look at MRIs and CTs and EMGs and the Tscan data. But tell us what your experience was with the screening, the neural occlusion screening that we spent the first day. So walk us through a visit. What was it like to see us?
Well, you're here for 3 days, and the first day is teeth cleaning. And it's very thorough teeth cleaning. I mean, they get a camera and they go into each tooth and they pull up the tooth and say, okay, this is what's going on with this tooth. This is what's going on with this filling. And you're just really informed of what's going on with your mouth. I mean,
yeah.
And then they also do the JVA, where they see the frequency of your joints and you see the data for there. I mean, it's very data heavy, which is what blew my mind, because all the dentists I've seen in my life, and I've met some really smart dentists, they don't have this kind of data that they can literally just throw up on the screen and be like, this is what's going on, this is what you need to watch out for, and this is what we're going to do today, and this is how you should be flossing and things like that. So that's the first day. And
so we did a full exam and cleaning,
full dental
and
exam.
We gave you a look at everything so that you could see it for yourself.
Yeah. So, there you're sort of informed. The second day is you get the MRI done in the morning, and the MRI is sent back to you, and then you get evaluated. You get the whole DTR evaluation, and that usually is about an hour.
Well, to be fair, the DTR part of it is actually the last 5 or 10 minutes.
Right.
Right? We're spending about 40 minutes on average looking at all the imaging.
Yeah.
Which really doesn't necessarily have anything to do with DTR. It has to do with just the whole problem, or problems, plural. We're trying to look for everything that could be wrong, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we were looking at cartilage, bone, we're looking for inflammation on the MRI, we're looking for fat marrow signal, make sure the bone's alive. We're looking to clock face the disc, remember? So based on the orthopedic end and what we see anatomically on the imaging, then at the very, very end, we proceeded to check you out with a T-scan and EMG.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so what I'm trying to say is, to be clear, the last 5 or 10 minutes is centered on bite, primary, metrics. The first 40 minutes or so is spent on, or sometimes an hour, on the imaging of the actual joints themselves and other things.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
So did you not find that enlightening to know what was going on? And we made you understand what the joints did too. We showed you
this
in a virtual program, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was that helpful?
I mean, that was, this is what actually is going on with your bite in correlation to your joints, and, just how you really try to make the patient understand orthopedically first what's going on, because, in your videos you talk about layers. Well, that's a very significant layer before you can even do DTR, is to look at the orthopedic stuff.
Yeah, you have to figure out, a lot of times, for example, like in your case, you had someone put you in an anterior deprogramming splint long term.
Mm-hmm.
So it opened your front teeth.
Yep.
Right? You have an anterior open bite.
Yep.
Which kind of sucks because we can't really DTR you because we can't get you on your front teeth, on your front circuit.
Mm-hmm.
We can, but we'd be making tusks out of your canines.
Pretty much.
So, but we know in your case, if you're okay with me putting this out there, we know with your case that you're relatively stable and adapted. Your joints are like what are called Piper 3As. That's not a bad place. It's not perfect, but it's not awful. So it's, your joints are relatively stable and adapted. We know this were confirmed, and we're not just relying on the joint vibration stuff, the frequency gadget you're talking about. We are looking at the actual gold standard, which is the MRI, which shows us cartilage. Mm-hmm. And we're looking not just at cartilage, we're looking at lateral pole and medial pole, the two halves of cartilage. And we're staging what each joint is doing, if it's torn out, based on Dr. Piper's protocols, which are amazing.
Right.
You know, the Piper classification system is like paramount to us deciding if you are a good candidate or not. And the only way to really know what the Piper classification is to have an MRI and a CT. Combine that data, and then you look for stability or lack thereof. So at the end of our neural occlusion screening with you, we found that, you know, you need to close your front teeth orthodontically. You need to go to find an orthodontist, right?
Yes.
And so what was your feeling? What did you think of that?
Well, you know, obviously you're going to be a little bit upset that, you know, it doesn't look like, you know, a predictable case in the sense of, you know, like, oh, okay,
quick
well,
fix.
It's like, yeah, like a quick fix. You know, yeah. With me, it was like, well, you have an obvious bite problem and, you know, you have, you know, an orthopedic problem. And, you know, something I didn't really mention to you until the next day when we were doing my fillings was I had a neck issue going on, you know. Something was up.
Most TMJ people have cervical inputs.
Yeah.
And by the way, the fillings were just something you had generic, a couple cavities.
Yeah.
We fixed that for you while you were here.
Yeah, no problem at all.
Yeah.
But, you know, and in that sense, it's like, well, you know, now I know what to do in a sense. You know, you're not like, you know, I don't know what to do. And when you come here, you get answers, essentially. You know, I mean, I had options, which was good. You know, it was like, we could do the DTR, but, you know, we would have to bond the canines, and then those canines would break, and you'd have to get veneers on those canines, and exactly, you know, you would have, you know, tusks, essentially. Mm-hmm. Or you go through orthodontics and try to close the bite, which I'm going to go do. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, in the ideal world, which, you know, I'm pretty sure you tell most DTR patients this, that in an ideal world, you want to fly down there and see Piper, you know, let him, you know,
If there's damage that's orthopedic,
yeah.
It's never a bad idea to see someone like Dr. Piper. There's not a lot of people like Dr. Piper. So I mentioned his name specifically. I mentioned another name, Ed Zibovitz in Maryland. Mm-hmm. Those are the two people we generally refer to, because I found over the years that I tend to get, or my patients that I send tend to get really good evaluations, very thorough.
Extremely thorough. And I've seen people on the Facebook groups who... you know, after seeing Piper, I mean, looks like they're kind of, their brain almost expanded because they learned so much more about what was going on, you know, orthopedically and just, you know, with their bite and everything. And, you know, just, I really don't think a regular surgeon would be able to analyze you as much as Piper would.
He's been doing this a long time. We're friends. I know him. It's not like I get any kind of kickback. You know, I respect him. I respect him because I know that he's measuring, and just like our Center for Neural Occlusion, you know, our big motto is measured matters. Measured matters, because if I can put a number to it and reproduce it, that's by definition a fact. If I can't, that's an opinion. Mm-hmm. So most of what dentists do for this kind of thing is very opinionated. It's subjective and it's not accurate. Yeah. So, you know, here's the kicker thing, though. This is not just about TMD world. This is about a dentist doing everything that he does to someone's bite. They're always altering bites, moving teeth with braces, changing fillings. Mm. We did a couple fillings on you, and at the end, you were a little bit off, remember?
Yeah, and I was like, you need to, you know, tone that down. And we were able to put the T-scan in and be like, okay, you know, reduce that.
And bingo. And we knew exactly that we were.
Yeah.
And that was a very practical, everyday example of, you know, had you walked out in a normal practice, doesn't matter what you feel.
They would have built it up too high.
That can cause hyperfunction in the muscles.
Yeah.
Your brain is basically trying to dial that thing in, get it flatter again to where it belongs. Not flatter, but in a better place. And we know from Kirstein's research and from my practical usage of that for many years, that if the back teeth are contacting too long in time, that pisses off brain basically, and muscles work harder to try to dial it back in. Mm-hmm. And if it can't dial it back in, the muscles are always working and they hurt. But before you apply those principles, you need to have an objective look at what's going on with the joints. So that's the whole point of it. So what did you want to know? The videos, you said there was a void. You've told me in the past, yesterday, that there was a void in the videos. You told me that you wished you'd known what patients experience when they come here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us?
Well, you know, you in, when you watch the videos, it's just like it shows you applying the DTR and, you know, you're doing the evaluation first, then you perform the DTR, and then, you know, you see how they act, you know, a day, 3 days later.
Sure.
But what you don't really see in the videos so much as what I experienced while I was here is everything else. So, you know, the 40 minutes prior of just going through the orthopedics and just going through the data, and the day before that, just the teeth cleaning, which, you know, I think is pretty crucial.
Well, it's a cleaning and it's a full exam. We're doing a very comprehensive exam on you.
Mm-hmm.
Cleanings, intraoral imaging, x-rays, you know, the normal stuff, but it's done very meticulously.
Yes.
I think is what you're saying, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, through that, you're able to, you know, at first you're coming from an angle of like, I don't want to know your background. I don't want to know, you know, how many splints you've worn. I don't want to know the amount of time you went through, you know, orthodontics or whatever. What I want to know is we're going to start off blank. We're going to start off with looking at your joints, and we're going to go from there, and we're going to get to this point, and you told me this, we're going to get to this point to see where everything kind of comes together, and ultimately, if you're a candidate for this or not.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I learned that my joints are relatively stable and adaptive. I'm hyper 3A, 4A, I guess. And, you know, like, it was an option, but, you know, I had an anterior open bite. That was blaringly obvious, and, you know, that's something I need to get working on, you know, as soon as I can.
So we're trying to send you off to the orthodontist, and we need him to pull your anterior teeth together, and you come back as needed. You may not need to come back.
Yeah, I might not to. You know?
You might find that everything's golden once they get the front teeth coupling again. But we've checked the status of your joints. You know, your hinges are relatively stable and adaptive. We know where your cartilage is. We know that you don't have massive amounts of inflammation. We know that your bone is alive. You know, we're looking at all these things that normal dental world doesn't understand.
No, they won't do it because they won't tell you, you know, like, I've never met a dentist in my life that has been like, you need to go get imaged.
No offense to them, but radiologists look so infrequently at this stuff that a lot of times their reports aren't exactly accurate. In other words, they're staging the entire disc. In other words, if the disc has two halves, they're worried about, did the disc tear? They don't worry about whether one half teared, one half didn't. Mm-hmm. That makes a big difference.
I didn't say that on my radiologist report.
No, you're not going to see it. There's very few. And the reason I'm so big on Dr. Piper and why I spend time with him and why we, you know, why he's, we're lucky to have him on the Center for Neural Occlusion, you know, the co-curriculum, is because he taught me to understand the difference between medial and lateral pull and how big a deal that is.
Mm-hmm.
How that translates into bite issues and how that can cause pain and all kinds of other layers. So we showed you when we first started out, the first thing we did was we started looking at virtual software that describes what's going on with the joint and how the skeleton, the teeth, the mandible, the maxilla, the cartilage, how, and even the cervical spine, how it's all related, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did this make sense to you?
Oh, absolutely.
You know, the fact that, you know, basically this is kind of a 1 o'clock disc, that's relatively normal. There's 12, you're tearing it forward, it's 11, 10, 9. Now you've lost the protection of the disc. So take it back to normal. Blue means teeth touch, white means teeth don't touch. Do the same thing, 12, 11, 10. So all of a sudden, what's the point? The point is the hinge alters the bite. It can do that readily and does that often. So we have to figure out if the hinges are stable and adapted or not.
Correct.
So a lot of people have, say, an 11 o'clock disc, and then the T-scan data will show us things that oftentimes matches up exactly with this program. Who built this program was Dr. Piper himself with his son as a software engineer.
Right.
So Dr. Piper's been looking at like, what, 25,000 joints in his career with MRI and CT, and then he's opened up surgically, what, 3,000-4,000 of them? So not only does he know what it looks like on the imaging, he knows what it looks like for real, so nobody knows better. So he found over the years that actually it'll even matter if you tear lateral or medial pole. Like here's just tearing the lateral pole. Lateral pole being the outer half of the disc. And then there's an inner half of the disc that's the medial pole. So back to normal. There's normalcy. So you got an outer half that's lateral and an inner half that's medial. Mm-hmm. So let's just tear a little bit of lateral. The medial's still intact. If the medial is still intact, like for example, this is you. You are like a Piper 3A, which is something like this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your lateral pole's a little bit torn. Your medial is still intact, And on your opposite side, you were something like that as well. This person, this virtual model, has torn cartilage. And every tooth is touching because all is blue. So the normal dentist doesn't even think about cartilage. They think everything is fine. And all of a sudden, that patient could be complaining about pain that's nonspecific. Could it be because the cartilage is pushed forwards into the muscle that's holding onto it? Of course it could. You know, but my point is, so what did this do for you? What did understanding this virtual program do for you, if anything?
Well, just where the cartilage is, you know, based on what my joint foundation is as of right now, you know, as of right. In the last few days. Because, you know, I never got imaged in the last 3 years that I've had TMJ. And, you know, I never knew, like, orthopedically, you know, what things were like. And, you know, even just using, you know, a simple program like that to, you know, just get you up to speed to, like, well, this is what's going to happen, you know, when you keep tearing cartilage off of the disc.
Sure. And there's your cartilage. In other words, this is not a perfect scenario, but that's okay. I mean, if we go into the medial, it's in better shape than it is on the lateral. Here's the lateral. You're like a 9:30 or 10 o'clock, you're torn out on the lateral half. And as we go in, we're going deeper, going more medially. Look how it's starting to climb up on top of it, because you're actually close to normal on your medial pole, which is what's the most important. Mm-hmm. So, and you don't have any big fluid buildups. You know, we look for that on T2 scans. We're looking for white, you know, for example, and there's no fluid there in your joint to speak of. There's a little tiny bit on your left lateral aspect. But the point is, these are the types of things we look at with MRI. So then we'll screen you. It's just a screening tool, joint vibration. This does not supersede the MRI. The MRI is the bomb. This is like the poor man's MRI. This is what we do on every patient that walks in here.
Right.
A normal patients, you know, forget people who come to us for TMD stuff. But a lot of the normal patients have TMD issues they don't even know about.
Yeah.
And this is one of the tools we use to help identify that.
Yeah. I mean, you did this for my teeth cleaning.
Yep.
You know, even before we
Everybody
did
gets
the evaluation.
This.
Yeah.
Everyone that walks in this practice gets this. And then we look at things, for example, just EMG, standalone. You know, are your muscles, when you're just idling along, resting, how are your muscles doing? Well, I put a number to it. So then we look at CTs, we look at calcium, we look at bone, and we're able to measure things. And there's your CT, the top of your jawbone. We're looking for stability. Yours is actually a nice dome shape, and the cortical bone's intact. The spacing is a little bit off. It's a little thicker on the medial than it should be. This is medial half. To the inside world, this is lateral half to the outside world. So, and then the MRI, we cross-reference, and we find on the MRI what's going on with the disc itself, for real. And that's how we cross-correlate things, soft tissue and hard tissue. So what did the CT mean to you? What did all the, did you understand, like MRI versus CT? Like, here's MRI, there's CT. Did that all make sense to you?
Well, I mean, you were able to spend time with me with both, especially the MRI, and really explain to me, you know, what's going on with the joint and what's going, I mean, with the CT scan, you really went into the bone, you know, and just where everything is in correlation to your joint, you know, bone-wise. And, you know,
right. We
looked at me and, you know, I was okay bone-wise.
Calcium. This is the CT, 3D imaging. And we can look in and out. This is the MRI. This is looking at hydrogen ions. So this one actually, this specific one is, the only way you can see cartilage is look at hydrogen, basically. There's no calcium in cartilage. So here's bone, here's brain, there's ear, there's your cartilage, that little black thing. So in other words, I can't tell with a CT where the disc is, but with the MRI I can. And I can stage that. And based on what position it's at, and that would take us back over to our anomalous software. Oh, we need to get rid of this guy. So based on the disc position, all of a sudden we know more about what the bite's doing, because again, the hinge, the TMJ, affects the way the teeth come together. And based on which teeth come together in time, there's neurology there that, you know, brain works muscle too hard, let's say. So that's, if a patient has good stable hinges, we can affect a change through the bite. But if the hinges are unstable, things are likely to break down over time. Why would we mess with your bite? We wouldn't. So, hence the problem when people aren't imaging back there. They don't know what's going on right here. And that's what's so critical, knowing what the disc is doing. So you get that now, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, and you just spend a really serious good amount of time, you know, just explaining the bone stuff to me on the CT scan. And, you know, see that you explain the CBCT scan and the MRI, that usually takes about 30 minutes, and the MRI, you know, probably at least 10 to 20 minutes, you know, so the patient is really, you know, clear and, you know, gets what's going on, you know, with both the MRI and the CBCT scan before you can even do the DTR.
Right. Well, it's important.
Yeah.
Like I was saying earlier, if you don't know what the hinge is doing, you can't know what the bite's going to do long term. So that's why it's really important. And that's why our training center, the Center for Neural Occlusion, that's why we're so big on the imaging. Because I've been doing this a lot of years, and I know that, you know, if I touch the wrong case, that's not going to help them. And that's the last thing we want to do, is we want to help as many people as we can and recognize when it is that we can't help them. So we're doing our best. So the very last thing we did for you, we're checking out your bite. We're on the T-scan data, the sensor, and the simultaneous data from the muscle. So this is muscle over here, force per unit time, the way the teeth come together, and simultaneous what the muscles are doing. So this tells us what's going on from your bite, and this is basically tapping into the neurology between the teeth and the brain and the muscle. So, and these are the tools that we use to do the occlusion time reduction therapy. Only after we know that the joints are stable and adapted, the hinges.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense, right?
Yeah.
So basically we could never get you off of your back circuit, your back teeth. So, I mean, look, you're at the end of the movement, you went to your right, and you couldn't get off your backs. That's because your front teeth don't couple.
No.
They don't come together.
No.
So we need you to move them orthodontically. But before we wanted you to go see the orthodontist, we wanted to make darn sure that your hinges are stable and adaptive, hence the MRI.
In your older videos, it's so much about, you know, the therapy, the treatment, you know, like, you know, just getting it done, and, you know, then they come out of it and they're feeling great and, you know, everything looks great. But, you know, what I really, I mean, because I've seen so many of your videos, like, countless times, like, mm-hmm. almost to a bit of an obsession. And, you know, what struck me was he really needs the video, just a pure evaluation
yeah.
of just screening, you know. And I was thinking to myself, I might not even be a candidate, or, you know, I might be, but I might not get it done. Who knows? I don't know until I see him. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we found out that, you know, maybe, but it's best to, you know, get that open bite closed. But, you know.
But you're lucky, because you can do that with braces.
Maybe.
You shouldn't need joint surgery, and you shouldn't need jaw surgery either. So I'm hoping that the orthodontist can get you almost closed all the way. And if he can't get you all the way, he'll at least get most of the way so that we could fix you with veneers or whatever we need to do, and then DTR it in
mm-hmm.
and make you better.
Exactly.
And along the way, you might find that you don't even need to get the DTR, because once the anteriors recouple, naturally things may get better on their own.
Yeah, and that happens with braces sometimes.
Yep, they can.
You know, as you've seen so many people who have come to you because of orthodontics.
Well, see, and that's the flip side. Sometimes yeah. people go into braces and they never dial in the final result. The end result is such that they're on their back teeth too long in time, or they've got a joint issue that alters the bite, like we saw with the anomalous medical virtual software. And then all of a sudden they've got hyperfunctioning muscles and mastication, they're in pain all the time, and life sucks.
Yeah.
You know, so the orthodontic thing, the bottom line is they've got to measure the result. Did you ever look at the Center for Neural Occlusion site? Did the CNO ever pop up?
Right, I think it was like a few days before I came here.
Yeah.
I went on it and I looked at the FAQ, and it was a very long FAQ.
Mm-hmm.
And you answered pretty much every question that would relate to the practice of DTR.
Well, or TMD screening. Because, you know, Center for Neural Occlusion, it's not just DTR. Center for Neural Occlusion. What we do here is we screen people with what I call neural occlusion. In other words, the protocols, the mix of the MR, CT, JVA, EMG, T-scan. It's not just DTR. This is more than what Kirstein's been doing. So we're looking at the hinges, right? To make sure that they're relatively stable before we start messing with potentially altering bites
mm-hmm.
or dialing them in, aligning them.
Because things would change. If you didn't
right.
screen the joints, then you could do the DTR, and then they might feel great for, you know, a few weeks or a few months,
and then
the next thing you
change.
Know,
mm-hmm.
the joint will change the bite, or, you yeah. know, if you have some serious neck stuff, you know,
yeah.
that can change the bite, and then it sucks. You've spent all that money, and you've gotten your teeth adjusted, and
yeah.
you know, your bite's off again, and your muscles are working again, and, you know, it's like sort of like it was, or, you know, it could get even worse.
Yeah, and see, part of our problem is, or not our problem, part of the mandate for the CNO is we're trying to get other dentists and doctors, physicians, whoever wants to listen, chiropractors, to understand that if they image, they can see more. And that a lot of times this bite stuff, you can't just trust what the dentist does. You got to measure the end result. That goes for the dentist too. I'm not ragging dentists. I'm just saying that's what we're taught in school. We're taught that bite ribbon is accurate. It's not. And we're taught that we just need to give somebody a splint for their TMJ problem. Well, that's not the case either. Depends on the case. Mm-hmm. You know, and all these different philosophies, they basically give the doctors one recipe on how to fix the patient.
Yeah.
The reality is there's all kinds of variations.
Yeah, and you know, it's hard for the patient because, you know, you come here and you learn so much about your bite and your joints and, you know, what to do. And, you know, in my case, it's like, you know, you have to go back and, you know, mm-hmm. convince, you know, people who don't know about neural occlusion and, you know, just, you know, the importance of measuring the bite that...
And the joint.
And the joint, you know, that, you know, it would be best for me to get this done because they all want to build you splints. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've gone through splints, and it messed up my bite, basically, you know. I wore that NTI, and, you know.
Now you got to go back to braces.
Now I got to go back on braces, yeah. And I was in braces for 3 to 4 years, and I had an amazing orthodontist, and, you know, I bet, you know, he's furious if he watches this video, because, you know.
Can you go back to him?
It's all in Singapore.
Oh, gotcha.
And yeah, he was not cheap.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah, that's a little too far to travel.
Yeah.
Every 6 weeks.
Well, just the fact that, you know, I'm going to have to go back and I'm going to see my orthodontist and he's going to be like, so you saw that guy in Arkansas? And I said, yes. And he's like, yeah. So did you get that treatment? And I said, no. And he's like, okay, so that was sort of a waste of time and money. I'm like, well, it wasn't. I learned a lot. But I need to get braces on and, you know, I'm in a process of getting a new splint made, which is a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And I have to be like, no, I need to do this. And, you know, I have to...
Put your foot down.
Yeah, you know, and that's, you know, when you have a TMJ problem, I think that is something you really need to just come towards at a certain point, is you have to put your foot down about stuff.
Yeah.
I put my foot down about coming here. I was like, that's it, I'm doing this. You know, I'm sick of dealing, you know, the traditional way. I want to come down here. And, you know, when you told me, it's like... Yeah. I need to go and do this.
You mean measure matters?
Yeah.
It really does?
Yeah. And, you know, you need to put your foot down about things like orthodontics or surgery. Yeah. I mean, you know, if you, you know, like, you can try and go as long as you can without getting surgery done if you're a surgery case, but eventually it's going to get to that point that it's going to, you know, you're going to get that MRI done in the future, and it's just blaringly obvious that you need to get the structure fixed.
Well, the cool thing about MRIs is it's just like any other disease process. If you have an image from like baseline today, and then another one 6 months later, you can compare. You can see if it's getting worse.
Right.
So people are so afraid, and they think it's so expensive. It's not that expensive.
No, it's like $600.
Yeah, it was. Here it is. I mean, I'm sure it's different in other places, but my point is, getting a proper MRI and then getting another one serially, you can actually see if things are changing or not, mm-hmm. and that's a huge advantage.
I mean, I just say for everybody, you know, really look into all the treatments you can get for your problem, and definitely, I mean, I really do implore people to at least get imaged as soon as you know you have a TMJ problem, just so you know what's going on with the joints, because for 3 years, I never did. No one ever told me to. I just listened to my dentist, and then I got to this point where, you know, what they were doing wasn't working, and I had to go see somebody who knew what they were doing, you know, looking at things orthopedically, and could point me in the right direction. And, you know, I'm not saying that DTR is the best treatment. You know, it doesn't work for everybody. And, you know, there's certain treatments that do really work for people. And, you know, all I want is just, you know, for everyone to find the treatment that works the best for them, because that's so important. Because, you know, living every day with TMJ is, it's really not fun. It's debilitating. And, you know, I just hope that, you know, everyone can find something that, you know, works the best for them. It's just... It's, you know, every day you wake up and you have a headache and, you know, you can't, you know, it's like Christmas, you know, like I look at my family, everybody can eat normally. No one's got a headache, you know, no one, you know, their muscles aren't like this, mm-hmm. you know, their body doesn't feel like it hurts. Their neck doesn't feel like it hurts. And, you know, in that sense, that's
when it's... They don't take it for granted. And you're thinking to yourself, man, just for Christmas, if I just had a couple days off of this problem, right?
Yeah, if I could just chew normally, and, you know, for my teeth to actually just And that's what I mean about it being, you know, just debilitating and, you know, just the pain that comes along with it, you know, just, it is chronic pain, you know, yeah. Every day, you know, waking up and, you know, you could have dreams that, you know, you're not dealing with a TMJ problem, that you can, you know, smile bigger and you can laugh and, you know, you can open your mouth all the way and, you know, you can eat whatever you want. And that's the thing, it's just the chewing so easily that I see with my friends and my family, and it's just like, you know, I'm trying to get it back, but you know, it's a journey.
It sucks.
Yeah. All right, thanks, Dr. Nick.